to the next in our series of Fresh Thinking Breakfast Seminars. It's been a while since we did the last one. Let's think of it as a sort of off-season period. But in the interim, my colleagues who are outside here just waiting for the last few guests have been out looking at some alternative venues. One of the pieces of feedback that we had after the last event, which was at the Four Seasons, for those of you who weren't there, was that the Four Seasons is a great venue. As a super brunch on a Sunday, but it didn't necessarily fit with this idea of fresh thinking. So we heard that piece of feedback and thought, let's go and look for some other alternative venues. So we're very pleased to welcome you today to the Nehru Planetarium, and we've got a number of other interesting, quirky and offbeat venues lined up for future events. One of the other pieces of feedback that we got was that we are not all known to each other. Now, we kind of know everybody, but it gave us pause for thought that not everybody knows everybody else. And so what we thought we would do was to start the morning by introducing ourselves. And what I'm going to do is ask you to answer three questions, or give three pieces of information. The first, your name. The second, the organisation that you work for or you're representing. And thirdly, a word, an adjective, which describes the culture of the organisation that you work for. Now, I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to just think about that. I'm assuming that you don't need time to think of what your name is. Kamlesh just got off a flight from China, so he might be slightly wondering where he is, but not who he is. You know where you are and who you are. So, your name, the organisation that you work for, and a word that describes the culture of the organisation that you work for. Yeah? And what I'm trying to do is get us in the mood for some thinking and for some participation. We're not interested in your life story, we don't want your CV, not an opportunity to make a pitch for your organisation or your consultancy services, but who you are, what your organisation is, and a word that describes your culture. Honey, do you want to kick us off?
Sure. I'm Honey. Hi, nice to meet
you.
I'm Master
Co-Founder
at Magenta, and I would describe Magenta as fresh. Sorry, girls.
Can we move up in this direction?
Okay, I'm Kamlesh Thakur. The organization I own actually is Prime Investment Limited, an investment banking company. We are transparent.
Okay,
good. Hi, my name is Himanshu. I present a business called Red Check Partners, and the word that describes us best is we are a service.
We are
a service.
A circus. All right. It's not strictly an adjective, but I'll let you have it anyway.
Pankaj Baliga, I just retired from the Tatas, and I just the word trust.
Is that me now?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Lucy. I'm going to say that I work for United Spirits, Diageo, because I basically do. And the word that springs to mind is, well, there's lots of words. I'm going to say,
fun loving.
Yeah.
You're allowed a hyphen.
I'm allowed a hyphen?
Yeah, hyphenation is acceptable. Gentlemen, before we move too far to the back.
Hi, I'm Jaydeep Shah. We represent an organization, Saurabhi Chemical Industries Private Limited. And the word which would describe us is world creativity.
Hi, good morning. I'm Rajiv Shah, Saurabhi Chemical Industries Private Limited. And as described, we stand for world creativity.
Hi, my name is Seema Shah. I'm a freelance consultant. If I describe the kind of three companies I'm working for at the moment, I would describe them as imaginative.
I'm Rachel Bishop, and I'm with the American School of Bombay. And I would describe the American School of Bombay as inventive.
My name is Jody Sobak. I also work at the American School of Bombay, and I would describe our culture as welcoming.
Hi, I'm Captain Alok Parashar. I'm also from American School of Bombay, and I would describe our culture as innovators.
Hi, I'm Barry. I'm from American School of Bombay, and I would say dream.
My name is Craig. I'm also from the American School of Bombay. I want to go last to hear what my colleagues have to say, and I would say that I would describe our organization as relevant.
Hi,
Neetu, and I'm a freelance teacher. I've done my Montessori, and I would describe that I love teaching children.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Adela Satabayaguna. I work for the Dow Chemical Company. I like to think of our culture as resilient.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Simon Driva. I'm working for Wooten Paints. It's a Norwegian paint company. I would describe our culture as equal and valuable.
Hi, I'm Sameer. I'm the founder at Bonsai. And one word to describe our culture would be customer focus.
Hi, I'm Saloni. I'm the designer at Magenta. And I would say one word to describe us is young.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. I know how old you are.
Hi, I'm Kirali. I'm a designer with Magenta. And I would describe us as colorful.
It was the culture they were describing, Lucy, not my age.
Hi, I'm Somik. I work at Magenta, and the culture would probably be enabling.
The question was, who are you? What is your organisation? And a word that describes the culture of your organisation.
My name is Christopher. Our business is chemicals, customer protection. Our company is called Patches. Our culture, I would say, is enabling, empowering, along those lines.
Thank you. Piyush, good morning. Lovely to see you.
Yes, you too. My name is Piyush. I work with SR Group, and I would say I love you long time.
Great. Have you covered everybody? Good.
Good words.
Yeah, so thank you all for contributing. So before I introduce Craig, well, Craig's introducing himself now, so actually I don't need to do that. I want to take a couple of minutes just to set the scene. We're currently involved in a very interesting piece of work that's looking at how companies in India are engaging their millennial employees. Median age in India is 27, and there are more than 10 million young people coming into the workforce every year, in essence a million people a month. We just talked about over breakfast, the fact that in India you can say there are a million people there, and you're not exaggerating, whereas you use that in other parts of the world to make a point. But the reality here is, you know, a million people coming into the workforce. That's creating all manner of opportunities, and one of the reasons why lots of foreign investors are keen to come and participate in the India story. It also creates quite interesting and sometimes quite complex challenges for organizations. The consultants Deloitte publish an annual survey. Some of you may have seen it. It essentially looks at millennials and their attitudes to work. And last year's report, which I think is the fourth, made quite an interesting observation, specifically about Indian millennials. It said that millennials in general rank an organisation's purpose very highly when it comes to making a decision about who it is that they will go and work for. And Indian millennials in particular are extremely concerned about the purpose of the organisation that they choose to go and work for. They're not simply interested in an organisation which is able to deliver costly financial results, but they want an organisation which has a higher purpose. They're looking for organisations which are able to articulate that purpose. So I think one of the opportunities for companies in India wanting to attract and retain the best and the brightest talent is to think about their purpose and find ways to articulate that. That's something that Craig's going to pick up when he talks a bit later. The title of the session is An Innovative Educator's Guide to Creating the Ambiance for Greatness. We're going to talk about how purpose, along with values and culture, are facets that allow organisations to perform. Before we get to the main event, I want to just tell you, share a brief story about a piece of work that we've been doing that also gets to the heart, I think, of the way in which organisations are able to adopt and articulate values that are important to them. Next month, Magenta will celebrate its fifth anniversary. Piyush has known us for all of that time, in fact a little longer. But throughout that period, we've been working with Tata Chemicals. That's an organization which has experienced a major transformation over the last 5 to 7 years. It's gone from being a purely domestic Indian producer of salt and soda ash to an organization with operations on 4 different continents. So they've acquired and rebranded businesses. They've acquired colleagues in other parts of the world. It's been quite a complex journey for them. One of the things that it's done is it's continually revisited and reviewed the way it articulates its vision and its mission and its values. And last year, Tata Chemicals reviewed its core values. I won't go into the process, which is actually quite an interesting case study. I'm just going to focus on what the result or the output of that was. What it did was it renewed its commitment to a series of values that include things like safety and integrity and excellence. So if you're in the Tata Group, things like integrity and excellence are, you know, core to your DNA. But they also added another value, and that new value was passion. Now, you know, this is a business that produces bulk chemicals, soda ash and salt. It's staffed with engineers and technicians. There's a sense in which passion is not really an obvious value for that organisation to be able to legitimately own. But actually what they did was that they realised, or they uncovered the fact that passion had been part of their DNA for the last 75 years, from the moment when somebody went and set up a soda ash business on the coast of Gujarat in a rather hostile and unfriendly terrain. Throughout that 75 years, that business had been driven by passion. And what they were doing was formalising something that was actually part of what they did all the time. And part of our recent work has been to help them articulate what passion means within the organisation. So we've done an interesting piece of work. I'm not sure where Raj is. I think he's just stepped out. So one of the pieces of work that he's just completed is interviewing more than 60 people in that organisation to understand what does passion mean for us in our working lives. And one of the interesting things that we uncovered in that was how organic that value was, how organic that sense of passion was. Passion means so many different things to so many different people. There isn't one, if you like, corporate interpretation of what passion is. Yeah, passion is owned by the people. It's their passion in the way that the other values that I mentioned, things like safety and integrity and excellence, really don't have the same sort of organic feel about them. When you ask people to describe them, you get a rather homogenous, sort of corporatized interpretation of them. Whereas passion is diverse, and it means different things, and it seems to pop up everywhere. Disappointed to say that our colleagues from Tata Chemicals have not been able to join us today, because I very much wanted them to participate in this conversation and to be able to give their perspective in terms of what that's meant for them in the organisation. But the last part of my story about Tata Chemicals before I hand over to Craig is this, that last year they appointed a chief culture officer. Again, it's a business which essentially produces bulk chemicals. It's not a sort of Google or a Flipkart or the type of, you know, millennial staffed digital organisations that you think would legitimately be able to say we have a culture officer. But they have, and they've appointed somebody very senior within the organisation. They've formalised culture as, if you like, a functional role. So, purpose, important if you want to attract and retain bright millennials. Values really have meaning when they're things which grow from within the organisation rather than being things which are imposed top down. And I think culture is an increasingly important differentiator, something that can create the atmosphere, or as Craig calls it, the ambiance for greatness. So I'd like to briefly introduce Craig and hand over to him. Craig was schooled in Punchkani. So India is very much in his psyche, if not in his actual DNA. He's a highly travelled and highly decorated educationalist, and he's also a published author. His roots as an educator and leader, as a soccer coach and athletic director. He and his family spent a period of time in Brazil, and then 6 years ago returned to India, where he serves as the superintendent of the American School of Bombay. As you will find in 30 seconds' time, he's an energetic presenter, and able to translate ideas that have been developed on the sporting field into the realm of the classroom and the boardroom. I'll hand over to you.
Thanks very much. So we can't have you all the way in the back there. So actually, I think as I'm looking at the size of the group, maybe we really do want to get everybody down into these first three rows. So just come on down, especially the two people from Magenta that are trying to hide in the back there. And then I think what I'm going to do is actually split up the ASB crowd. And if the ASB crowd can sprinkle themselves around, I think you two work for the same company too. Maybe you slip in here. So we still have some empty chairs. The reason I'm bringing you down is we're going to have moments during this where I'm going to say, talk to the person next to you. So let's make sure that we're at least sitting next to one or two people to have a conversation about that. Perfect. So I think I see at least everybody. Maybe the best thing is if you scroll one. There we go. So everybody's got somebody to their shoulder. Perfect. Rachel, you can share right there. Mark could not have set up our time together better than what he did there. So I did not bring any cards with me. As soon as I arrived, somebody asked me for a card. So I came running in here and I typed my email and my Twitter account. If the topic and some of the resources that I share with you are of interest to you, you might want to follow me on Twitter, because that's kind of where I continue this conversation with whoever follows people on Twitter. So Mark said it very well. Let me tell you how this talk came to be. Obviously, we're a client of Magenta, and we're a very highly satisfied client of Magenta. And we began to engage with each other in many different forums. And then I think we just started talking about what could I give back sort of to Magenta, and this possibility came up. We sat down, we started talking, and we started talking about these things. We started talking about people. I know a few things about people because the American School of Bombay is the largest employer of expatriates in India. We have more expatriate visas working for us, and those expatriate visas come from almost every country. So we have our Aussies, our Kiwis, our South Africans, and our Brits, and our French, and our Canadians, and they all make up a very diverse group of people. And so that's it, people, we'll talk about that. Purpose, all of the research, sort of the joint research especially coming out right now, millennials, highly, it's online, you can download it, you can read it, it's fascinating. Purpose is becoming more and more important to a generation of workers. Like, ask the question, sort of the creative, critical thinking question of why are we doing what we're doing? Why am I here? Those are the kinds of things. So people plus purpose plus values equals culture. So this is I'm going to share several equations with you today. I have an equation that says if you have the right people plus a clear purpose, and the purpose can be an apple or the purpose can be a banana. I don't care what your purpose is, as long as it's clear and your people understand the purpose and your people buy into the purpose. So if you have the right people plus the purpose plus a value set that your people all buy into, then you have a culture. This could be a very toxic culture. It could be a very shark-like culture. It could be a very empowering culture. It could be everything that we just mentioned. It could be a freeing culture, it could be a colorful culture, it could be a very terrorizing culture, it could be a culture of fear. A culture of fear is easily created by a certain set of people with a very certain purpose and certain values. And remember, by not valuing something, you have actually agreed to value something else. So that creates a culture. What I'm going to try and weave through today is, how can people, purpose, values equally a culture? The culture that I've been asked to talk about is the culture of greatness. And once again, Mark said that as well. Words like excellence, words like greatness, those are kind of, you almost think we all would agree on what that means. But I'm going to test that. And I'm going to see, do we all really understand what an ambience of greatness would look like? So if you were to walk into an organization as a cultural auditor, would you be able to audit on a scale of 1 to 10 how great that culture is? I think by the end of our time together, you might have some idea of how you might create that. So my job today, as an educator and as sort of a thought leader in this area of culture, is to present you with a framework. you're going to leave today. The last slide I'm going to show you is going to have this incredibly, almost a calculus-like equation. It's going to have about 12 different variables. And you're going to take this framework, and you're going to adapt it, and you're going to customize it into your organization, not only your organization, but I'm going to say a few other things. So I give you the framework, you need to give it context. What I'm going to talk about, I'm going to base it on 4 or 5 big, important pieces of research. And then you need to say, how does that speak to the chemical, I guess, company or the organization? How does it speak to family? Another thing over here is, a lot of people in my question and answers at the end, they will ask questions about their children. I made a presentation on mission and culture at Goodrich Leadership, the global Goodrich Leadership, a couple years ago. I would say half of the questions by the end were about their families and their kids, because of mission, values, cultures, the changing culture within India. The world is flat, the world is small, India culture is changing, the new generation coming up, why do I have to celebrate Diwali, why do I have to go to temple, those kinds of questions. So as we do this today, think to yourself, how is this ambience of greatness applicable to me as the CEO, or as the marketing director, or as the graphic designer, or as the team leader of whatever? What about my colleagues? A lot of what I'm going to share with you today, you can really take back and apply to a team. Even if you don't lead the team, you can get a team to think about these things. Obviously, your companies and your families and your kids. I never read anything from an educational lens or from a leadership lens without thinking of my 3 sons. I have 3 sons. My oldest is 34. My youngest is 25. Any mistake that could possibly be made by a parent, I have made them several times. So I'm constantly looking and reflecting and refining. I want to begin, and I'm going to throw out some, like I said, some resources. There's a great book that's now a couple years old by John Medina called Brain Rules. The amount of learning we have had in the neurological field in the last 5 or 6 years is actually the equivalent of the past 100. The field of neurology is just really exploding with new insights and information. So neurologist John Medina says, all of this great research, no one understands it. So he literally takes neurology and he makes it into a super easy book. I'm not a really smart guy. I like nice, easy books that I can sit in the evening at 9 o'clock and read a chapter or two. And he breaks down the most recent research in neurology into 12 simple principles. And as you read these, half of them will be intuitive. You're like, of course, I knew that. It makes sense with how the research is supporting it. And the other half will be actually counterintuitive. You're like, no, that can't be right. And it is. We, much like once upon a time, I don't want to go there, where we thought perhaps cholesterol was good, cholesterol was bad, eggs were bad, now eggs are good. There's this counterintuitive. With research, we find out more and more. So the 12 principles, I share this because I want to begin by saying, One of the indisputable, you cannot argue with facts is, if you have a group of people that is greater than 7, and if you talk at them for more than 10 minutes, you've lost 70% of the engagement factor. So having said that, you need to know that every 9.5 minutes in the next hour, I will ask you to somehow get engaged with each other. But you also need to think about that from your organization, and you also need to think about that from a family perspective, you need to think about that from a team perspective. If the research is saying that the human brain that is not actively engaged, and actively, I'm not talking about cognitively, I'm talking about actively engaged, I've asked you a question, I've asked you to share, I've asked you to put back, to summarize, then we're actually losing 70% of your engagement. Imagine the power of the workforce that we've lost. Take a moment to think about your educational experience. If you did go to an incredibly traditional, conservative educational structure, how much of your potential might have been lost because you were not actively engaged in that. I grew up in India. I grew up in Panchgani. I actually sat my SSC exams in Marathi. And when I look back to my educational experience in India, I don't say that I'm a product because of it. I'm actually a product in many ways in spite of it. You know, I really think that 70% of my education at times, I was not engaged at all. And I look at that time, it's kind of a wasted time. So John Medina, Brain Rule. 2 of the other things about impact, and I want to share this with you, once again from John Medina's work, is the following. There is a lot of research on if you summarize or if you take notes versus not taking notes. And that's why we have the pads, that's why we have the pencils. Or if you are asked to draw similarities or to make comparative analysis of things, your retention and your test-taking results are going to be different. In other words, if this room, we divided it along half, and somebody gave a 26-minute lecture on something, and this half we said, you can take notes, and you must summarize, and you must share with each other. You cannot take notes, but pay close attention, and we're not going to ask you to summarize, and we're not going to ask you to contrast. And then at the end of that, you all went for a snack, all came back, and we gave you a test. How much better do you think this side of the classroom would do compared to that side of the classroom? Just take a shot. 60%. 60%? She's giving 60% value to note-taking, summarizing, and comparing. Somebody want to go higher or lower? 75%.
On that side.
Oh, you would say they would be more effective.
Yes.
This is coming from the gentleman who's not taking notes.
Right? I'm taking notes.
He is going to stand his ground. Let's go to a test. Yes.
You know, the taking notes would be about 80 to 90%, perhaps even 100% more effective.
So you're saying they would score 20 out of 40 and you would score 40 out of 40?
Yeah, because taking notes makes imprints on the brain.
Yeah, yeah. So. Last one.
I'm with a gentleman over there.
You're with a gentleman also. Yeah. Very optimistic and very wrong, but it's only this, which only. This is a huge number. And this is, it's not that you can debate this, it's a fact. The group, equal groups. Now you can't put the smart people on one side or the audio learners on one side, the kinesthetic learners on the other. It's got to be equal, and this is the kind of impact you make. Once again, as the brain. Imagine your young interns, your young people coming in. A lot of what I'm going to talk about right now is as a leader of a team, you'll be asking some questions of your people. So John Medina's work. So if I were you right now, and if you wanted to get 34 to 40% more out of what I'm going to share with you, I would take a look at dividing my notes into this. I'm going to spend my time talking about people. I'm going to spend my time talking about purpose, values, and strategies. This is a picture I took this morning when I was going through my Prezi at the last minute. I said, let's see what I actually accomplished with regard to the task that Mark gave me. And I went through and took a look at everything. I'm talking about people. Where am I hitting purpose? Where am I addressing values? What strategies am I giving you as members of organizations to sort of create more of an ambiance of greatness and some resources? Okay, going back to the ambiance of greatness, what I'd like to do is you cannot talk about greatness today, 2016, without making reference to Jim Collins' book, Good to Great. What's interesting, though, is my generation, this was kind of one of the four books that was on our dresser. We kind of in our 40s, this is the book that was kind of our Bible of leadership, was the Good to Great. But then it kind of lost a bit of its spotlight. But if you were to go back now and revisit the work of Collins, you would once again, it's like watching an old movie over, you're like, wow, you really kind of nailed it. So for those of you unfamiliar with the work of Jim Collins, he was at the Stanford Business School and the Stanford School of Leadership. And he had just published a study called Built to Last. And this had studied about 2,000 organizations that had lasted over 100 years. So they had, what was it about these organizations in the Built to Last that allowed them to exist and to thrive for over 100 years? And it was a big hit. And he went on the lecture tour. And he was filling auditoriums talking about Built to Last. And as he tells the story, in one of these engagements, someone raised their hand and said, Dr. Collins, I get it. I understand how the Built to Last, awesome. I'm just now starting my company. I will not even be around 100 years from now. All of these lessons are wonderful from a historical perspective. But the question I have for you, Dr. Collins, is, how did those companies become great enough in their younger years to last 100 years? And he said, I have no idea, but I'm going to make that my next study. So he went back to Stanford, he put a team of researchers together, and they began to take a look at why do some companies leapfrog beyond other companies? And they began this by looking at 1,500 companies that were more or less in the same ballpark. So they took 1,500 companies across all different kinds of sectors, hospitals, paper companies, whatever, but they had to have had stock on the market for X number of years. And they said,
Let's study all of them and any of the companies within 15 years of our beginning of our study. If they triple the stock value of their competitors, we'll consider them great. So this is the first seed I'm planting in you. What is your definition of greatness? Collins' team said, our definition of greatness is 3 to 4 times the stock value that was once equal. So in other words, in 1980, both of our companies, our stock value was equal. Now, 15 years later, mine is quadruple of what yours is. You are a good company, I am a great company. That's the study. Of the 1,500 companies, only 14 cut the final test. So of the 1,500 companies, only 15 made the final cut. And look how often we use the phrase great. Collins says there are only 15 out of 1,500 that are great companies. The rest are good, really good, a little better than the others. They're not great companies. So that's where this sort of begins. So Collins has defined great as 3 to 4 times the value. He's using stock price. But also, this clearly says being great is not an innate talent. Now, if we had more time, if I was running an all-day workshop with your team, I would actually do the following. I would say, everybody stand up. Let's say that, you know, whatever it's selling, the ability to really sell something is an innate skill, 100%, or it's a 100% learned skill. And where on this bell curve do you stand? And we can debate the impact of learning how to sell on the effectiveness of selling. He says it's not an innate talent or skill, but it's the result of something else. And in this study, Collins finds it's the result of 5 things. He says, the great companies have these 5 things. And this is not why I'm here today to talk about Jim Collins, but I want us, on your piece of paper, to define your definition of great. So take 30 seconds to say, I told you what Collins is. Collins is 3 to 4 times the value of everybody else. What would be your one sentence definition of great in your business, in your sector? Just take a second.
Measurable.
So number one, that's your definition, right? Greatness should be measurable.
Well, I'm asking.
I would lean on the side of yes, measurable. So relative. So I, as Mark mentioned, I was in Brazil for 15 years, and I was in Brazil coaching football, soccer. So for 15 years, I coached under 18 boys soccer in Brazil. Okay, stay with me. And then I came to India, where I'm now coaching the under 18 boys in India. And I think for the first couple months of the practice, the boys must have been very disappointed in the kind of feedback I was giving them. Because I wasn't very complimentary. I wasn't impressed. I was watching 18-year-old boys do something that I had spent 15 years watching 18-year-old boys do something much more sophisticated. And I had to recalibrate what was good, what is great, and you had to come up with a definition of what that would be so we could all agree as a community, what is our value, what is our culture, what is our understanding of high performance. And that's an important, I cannot think of a better data comparison for me, football in Brazil, football in India. Those are two very good, you know, cricket here, cricket in Brazil. Trust me, you'll understand the difference there. So, I'm not going to ask for some feedback on this. I want you to think about this, but I did this morning. I just actually Googled great. So, great, some of the synonyms of great is substantial. Some of the synonyms are inordinate, exceptional, to an extent above average. So in other words, what's the average in Brazil football player? I can create a great standard there. What's the average performance of football here in India? I can now create a great standard here. So as I think about this, a really good definition is great, when you make something great, or you're great at selling something, or you're a great winner, is the following. Is that you are doing much more than somebody else, but with the same resources. I think that's the differentiator. In other words, the best cricketers in the world, cricket's a bad example, let's go with basketball. The best basketball players in the world are 6'7". They have a muscle mass of, they have a body weight fat index of, they have a vertical jump of X, etc. But how can, if they're great, they can only be compared to people who have the same resources. So here, for this definition as we move forward, being great at selling, being great at making, is that you can do much more than someone else with the same resources. If you have different or better or more sophisticated resources and you're producing a higher quality product, that's really not fair. You should be. I expect that. I tell our kids at graduation, when you're graduating from American School of Bombay, I cannot compare you to anyone else in India, and very few other schools in the world have given you the education that we have. So the expectation of performance is exponentially higher. These kids have been given everything. They have the best education, the best network, the most amazing sophisticated resources, real family support. They've got everything waiting for them. If they do not be fantastic, it's actually a disappointment. As a point, it is. I tell them at graduation, congratulations, you're actually a diploma, you accomplished nothing yet, let's go. And most of the parents appreciate that, some don't. I literally tell them, you have graduated from one of the, which, you know, we received the award last year as the most innovative school in the world. And it's like, you've now graduated from this school. Everybody's watching, what are you gonna do? So, the same resources? No, you have very different resources. So the definition of greatness there. So going back to Collins just real quick, this is all of Collins' book in a single slide. Collins says, these are the good companies, good, 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 good. They all went through 15 years ago, and then boom, something happened, and 14 companies broke through to become great companies. And when they went to these great companies, and they spent 3 years researching them, 3 years asking questions, they literally divided, I guess there's six things, not five. And I don't want to spend too much time on this, but level five leadership, they said a lot of the company breakthrough had to do with the top leadership, the CEO of the company and the top leadership team. Ironically, for those of you that are interested in the story, when Jim Collins sent his millions of researchers out into the world, he said, don't focus on leadership. Let's try and debunk that it's about the leader. Because, let's do that. They all came back after the first year of research, and they said, Jim, we tried. We really tried not to focus on the leader piece, but it kept coming back in the interviews. It kept coming back to the leadership, the single symbolic number one leader and the leadership team. Level five, and I won't go into level three, level four, level five, you can just do your homework on that. Number two is really about this first who and then what. The great companies went out and they interviewed and they recruited people first, and then positional, and we all know this, it's the people. And as an educator, this is tricky business. I go out to hire a high level physics teacher. Do I want a physics teacher with a physics degree from this university and experience at this wonderful school? Or do I want a really effective teacher that can teach physics? Or do I want a physicist that can teach? Right? The who and the what. Confronting the brutal facts. This is where I was mentioning to someone, I was going to mention, make an allusion to Tata. Last night on the news there was something, and I don't know my homework, I know there's some Tata people in here, so I may actually be saying something very pedestrian, but Tata is beginning to get rid of some of the things that they used to do, and they're realizing this is not anymore important to the core of who we are. That is what great companies do. Great companies get over the nostalgia, and some of the companies in the book are, we started by being a paper product company, and now 30 years later they cut the paper company part out. They've just said, even though that's what started us, but that's also what's driving us now. You know, you've got to cut that. The American School of Bombay is going through this right now. Our director of research and development will be leading us at the end of next year. She's created an enormous amount of resources and satellites for our school. And as she leaves, we're going to begin to ask ourselves, what can we actually sustain and enhance in her absence? Who would we hire to do it? And we're going to have to cut some things that in the past perhaps were really important to us, but we can't sustain anymore. That's called confronting the brutal facts. Another great example is this. My team is way along the process of getting a new website. I mean, we're like in the final stages of a new website, and just yesterday we sent out an email to the planning team going, should we just cut this fifth page altogether? Because the whole thing is built on five principles. And all of a sudden we're saying, this fifth principle is just not resonating with us. Can we just cut it? And we think of all the work we've done, the marketing and everything else, and we're just gonna cut it. We're confronting the brutal facts is to keep it for nostalgia, to keep it because we've worked on it, to keep it because we've been talking about it forever, or just step up and say, you know what, cut it. Let's just get it done. There's a great article by a Harvard professor, I can't remember her name right now, and she uses the Vietnam War as an example for her case study, and it's called In March of Folly. In other words, marching in folly. And she basically said the US government knew 3 years ahead of time they would not win this war. But they didn't have the courage to say pull out. They just wanted to, they just couldn't, they didn't have the leadership courage to say, so they just kept going. So in March of Folly, confronting the brutal facts. The hedgehog concept I'm going to show you in a moment, which I think is one of the fascinating things of greatness. And then a culture of discipline and technology. In other words, people, purpose, and values. The metaphor that Jim Collins uses for people is he says, make sure you have the right people on the bus first. Then figure out where to put them in which seat. It's a really powerful metaphor. I don't actually like the bus so much because it's just seats. I like the Starship Enterprise, where you have someone who's navigating, someone who's translating, someone who's creating engineering, someone who's doing some other things. In a bus, we're all kind of like sitting. But it's important, metaphor from, get all the right players in the bus and start the journey, and then figure out who's going to sit where. And that's an important metaphor, I think, for the Collins work. So this is the Collins thing, just to set us up with a good to great conversation. Just a bit on his hedgehog. And I think, once again, if we're looking about an ambience of greatness, if we're looking at purpose, and we're looking at values and cultures, he basically says the great companies have identified their hedgehog. And let's not get into what a hedgehog does, let's just say their core business. Let's say hedgehog is core business. And the way this Venn diagram here is, as a company, what are we deeply, I think Mark said, what are we deeply passionate about? Are we deeply passionate about the paper business? Are we deeply passionate about working with schools? Are we deeply passionate about the export? What is it that we are deeply passionate about? And list everything we're deeply passionate about. By the way, every 10th grader at the American School of Bombay goes through this exercise for 3 weeks. What are you passionate about as a 15-year-old kid? Write it down. So they've got a list of passion. And then we say, what if you invested the time and if you had the resources, could you actually be the best in the world at? Make a list. So they make a list. So a couple days on passion, a couple days on proficiency. You may not be the best yet, but if you have the right mentors and the right university and the right whatever, you could actually, you know what? I could be like world class at this. For a 15-year-old right now, journalistically, I think I can write and hold my own against any other 15-year-old in the world right now. Boom, put it down. And lastly, and this is what the parents love, what would actually pay the bills? What would pay the bills? And where these three come together is where now as a 15-year-old and looking at university, you need to start considering. I would challenge you as a team and as a company, go back and do this, and you will see so much of the work you are doing falling outside of this. And that's resources, that's time, that's money spent to something that's not your hedgehog. How can you be great if you are not absolutely focused, like surgically focused on what you, this hedgehog, right, your core business? So, for instance, me, I'm deeply passionate about writing. I published a book, made a couple thousand dollars in a decade off the book. I'm deeply passionate about this, okay? What could I be the best in the world at? I could probably be the best middle school English teacher in the world. I could, but I have a different lifestyle. A lifestyle that I probably have to, it's not gonna pay for my economic engine. So over here, I know I can be the head of a very A-level, top tier school. That will pay for my lifestyle, my dreams, my all of that. So where does all this come to? It all comes to the American School of Bombay. I need to be at the American School of Bombay. Because I can write, I can speak, I can lead workshops, I can work with 8th grade kids, I can coach football, and it can also pay for my economic engine. All of that comes together. So this, I think, is what the great companies spend a lot of time on, and as Mark said, Tata revisited it again. Because what was once your hedgehog, leadership team has changed, landscape has changed, market competition has changed, and job, the world politics have changed. Let's go back and take a look at what's paying our bills. What are we really the best at? The other thing, you know, just looking at the auto industry in this country, Tata could not have competed had they not gone in and taken a look at what they do and when, etc. So if you use out there the word hedgehog, everybody knows you're talking about Jim Collins' thing here. Great exercise to do with your children. Great exercise for you to do with your spouse. Great exercise for you to do with your team and your company. So that's the first two resources. We've got the John Medina Brain Rules that I highly recommend you, especially if you have young children, for you to start having the kinds of conversations about the way their brain works and to actually make sure that they have the right landscape for them to accelerate. The second piece I'm going to share with you is Rasmus Hankerson's The Goldmine Effect. Very quickly, the story on Rasmus was he was going to be the greatest footballer to ever come out of Sweden. He was a 14 and 15 year old phenom. All of the biggest football companies clubs in the world were trying to get him to come play for them. And Sweden was very excited about it. And then long story short, boom, blows out both his knees at the age of, I think, 17 or 18, playing career over, drops into a deep depression. His only dream, his hedgehog was professional football. And all of a sudden that would no longer be a possibility. So he bounces out of the depression and he decides to coach. And he says, now I'm going to coach, but I have no money, and I don't have, no club wants me to coach, and I'm 23, and I'm not going to wait to be 45 to coach Premier, so I'm going to start. So he goes out into the boonies, he buys a farm, he just plows down a field and creates a really second-rate soccer pitch, and then he goes and picks up players that nobody else wanted, and he brings them in, and he starts training, and starts competing in Division 3, moves up to Division 2, etc. But the key in probably chapter 4 is the following. He and his soccer coaches, from their first batch, they said, put the name of which of our 40 players you think will be our first player to sell. Who's the player that's going to be our big money player? Now that we've seen them for a couple weeks. So they all write down the name in an envelope, and they'll stick it into a drawer, and they go about their business. They forgot about the envelopes. 3 or 4 years later, Rasmus opens up a thing, he sees the envelopes. He's like, oh my God, let's check these out. There's like 12 envelopes from his original 12 coaches about the original 40 players, and he looks at it, and they were all wrong. Not a single person that they thought during the first tryouts was there, but they had already sold 3 players to big clubs for big money. So he said, okay, we got something wrong here. How did that happen without us knowing it was going to happen? And he went back and he deconstructed all of this, and all of a sudden he realized, I don't want to be a football coach anymore. I have just become a priceless talent scout. I can now pick out talent better than anybody because I have this formula. And he went and he did it. And he published the book. And I'm going to share with you, once again, you want excellence? Take a look at his studies. So he spent the next 5 years in 4 countries. He went to Jamaica to study what? What does Jamaica do better than anybody else in the world? They run. But what do they run?
Sprints.
Okay, so the Jamaicans are the best 100 and 200 meter runners in the world. Not by a little, by a lot. For a country that only has X number of people, they have more than their share. If you go back to Jim Collins, they have 3 to 4 times their competition in sprints. So he studied the sprints. I'm not going to tell you what he pulled out of Jamaica yet. Then he went to Sweden, back to his home country, and he studied what? All sports. No, what kind of skiing?
Cross country
skiing. This town of Tarnaby, Sweden, has, I think, like 30 people living in the town. And of the 30 people, 10 hold world records.
No pressure.
Yeah, it's like when you're born in Tarnaby, you're supposed to be an Olympian. You know, so he studied this, and he pulled something out of that. I mean, it's talk about four times, this is like 1,000 times your competitor. The population of this town is so minuscule, and yet they own 80% of all world records in cross-country skiing. What is going on in the water there? He went and studied. Then he went back to Africa. Then he went to Ethiopia. There he is in the back. You can see the one white guy running. And what did he study here?
Long distance
running. He tells a great story of going to a pub, and they're watching on the television, they're watching some run, and the first 10 guys that finish are all Ethiopian. And he says, you know, once upon a time, all the records were held by Brits, white Brits, and they don't believe him. They think he's kidding. Because they grew up at a time when there wasn't even television, and they thought all the people whose names were being mentioned on the radio just were Ethiopians. He said to the reader, he's saying, I know you think I'm making a joke, but I'm not. They're like, no way that there was anyone but Ethiopians winning this ever from the beginning of time. So he studied that. And lastly, he went to Brazil. And before I tell you the story of Brazil, he published the book before the most recent World Cup. So he went to Brazil to study football. And in football, his studying of the football was, if it wasn't for European rules and policies against how many foreign players can play on a team, all of the clubs in Europe would be full of Brazilians. And he just says, no German would play, no Brit would play. And he's saying, I'm sorry, but you wouldn't. It would be full of Brazilians. And then the World Cup came, and then I think his thesis was kind of destroyed by the Germans. But he studies Brazil, and he puts out his Brazilian thesis. And what I'm going to do with this is, I'm going to show you his thesis. And this is basically, all of this boils down, I'm boiling all this down to a very simple thesis for you to walk out of here and to say, how do people, purpose, values build an ambience of culture? And you've all seen, you know, X and Y diagrams like this. He says, this is basically performance. This is a low performer. This is the highest performer. This is low potential. This is really high potential. And these three things are, this person here, just so we all understand the diagram, this person has very high potential, but they're performing very poorly. This is a person who's got, you know, mid potential, he's performing mid. And this is the kid up here who's high potential and high performance. And this is where we want our entire team, our company, ourselves, our children to be. In education, we call this like the underachiever. This is the very frustrating kid, right? This is the underachiever who the parents know they're brilliant and the teachers know they're brilliant, but they're not happy in school and they're not performing well in school. And then they take a standardized exam. Boom! They score perfect score. But their report card, all, you know, 60%, 60%, because they're not doing their homework, they're not engaged. So that's it. This is the kid, once again, who loves school, right? This is the kid who's like, give me more homework, can I have extra credit? They never skip school. School is designed for those kinds of kids and takes their potential and really maximizes it. And these are the kids more or less in the middle. So in our companies, in my team, I have a team of 7, it's people that report directly to me, they're all over the map. Where's their potential and where's their performance? It's all over the map, often depending on the task. And the task oftentimes have a lot to do with what are you passionate about, what do you enjoy, and we'll take a look at that. So when Anderson is talking about this, this is his formula. He says, you can maximize potential by minusing X. He studied these countries, he went and talked to the coaches, he talked to the athletes, he talked to the award winners that were now 65 years old, and he said, tell me more and more about how you became so excellent in this. And his equation is, the potential of the cross-country skiers, the potential of the sprinters, minus X, gave them their peak performance. What I'd like for you to do with the person next to you is try and figure out what X is. What did Ankerson's research say, if you remove this from my potential path, I will give you my peak performance? Talk to the person next to you, try and figure out what is the X in this equation. Take a minute.
That X is the same for everyone.
Can I, Lucy just made that, just real quick. Lucy's question was, is the X the same for everyone? And the answer is, not only is it the same for every one of the athletes, it is the same for the businessmen, doctors, lawyers, everybody. If you can take this X, minus it from your potential, you will be peak performance.
To respond to the obstacles. And then you look back a year or so later, you go, we removed the obstacle. Let's take a look at our performance. So what I would do, a strategy that I would do with your teams is to really identify two obstacles that you think, and you know what? Once again, it's a style thing. I can look right into the eyes of one of my direct reports and say, do you believe that this quarter has been your peak performance? Just tell me on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the best quarter you ever had, where would you put today? And they would say, I'll give myself an 8. And it's a very fair question, why is it not a 10? I'm not kicking your butt because it's not a 10, I'm just simply asking what stopped it from being a 10? Well, you know, my dad was ill, I traveled a lot, I went back to the US. Great obstacle, okay? Can we do anything about that obstacle? Alok had this conversation with one of his people recently, and the obstacle was my father's ill and he's in Kerala, and Alok brought the father to Bombay. And we put him up here in a hospice because this person needed to be at peak performance in this very important quarter. So, or we can't deal with the obstacles, so let's eliminate. So I think once again, and then if you dig into your people's obstacle to find out, is it really authentic an obstacle, or is it an excuse, is it an illusion, is it a unicorn, what is it? So let's go back to this. The big obstacle for cross-country skiing is probably access to slopes. Didn't exist. Big obstacle to most sports is access to competitive competitions. If you want to be a great footballer in Brazil, you better be a great footballer. By the way, the one area that Brazilian players never get good credit for is they have the best goalkeepers in the world. They do, because they have the best offense in the world. People don't realize this. These goalkeepers grow up defending against Brazilian attack. And then Brazilian defenders also, forget this last World Cup, brilliant defenders. Why? Because they're against Brazilian attack, all the way through the club system, right? Then they go to the World Cup, the goalkeeper hardly touches the ball. And they don't get credit. And some of the US goalkeepers get all this credit because we're not very good. So our goalkeepers always get goalie of the tournament, right? Because they have like 90 saves in this game. Alright, so what Ankerson then does, he takes a bit of Collins's thinking and also says, the first who and then what. And Ankerson now is going to give you four questions. And I'm going to give you these four questions, and these are the four questions he said. You want to really know your people. You want to really allow your people to maximize their peak performance. You want this culture of excellence and greatness, ask them these four questions. And not only ask them these four questions, just real quick, ask these same questions of multiple people about that person, and then also start building up evidence to support their answer. And I'm going to walk you through this. So question number one, a very important question for Mark to ask his team is, why or how or when do you seek coaching? So let me just share another small anecdote to hit this home. Moving into next year, I've charged all of my direct reports that we work 220 days a year. And I told them, of the 220 days next year, 40 of those days, I want you gone somewhere else. I want some other company, some other school, in some other place in the world, to fly you in as a pro bono consultant on something. And I just want you to look at that. And of my seven people, five of them were like, yes, I know exactly what I'm going to do. And two of them were like, who would pay for me to come to their school, even though I'm free, to serve as a consultant on something? I need to think about that. And what a wonderful moment for them to start thinking, what am I really the best in the world at? Or what could I actually bring value? If all I'm doing is logistical stuff, if all I'm doing is just supervising student behavior, then probably nobody wants that. But if I'm an expert in, you know, standards-based reporting, if I'm an expert in project-based learning, if I'm an expert in leadership and critical thinking curriculum development, people would like to have that. So here, when and why and where do you seek development? And then ask other people about them. When does Craig come to you for coaching? What would the nuances of that situation be that he comes to you for coaching? We were just talking earlier outside about someone who called me last night, and I judged them because of the quality of their question. I said, how can this person be asking me, the head of the school, this question? There's something broken in this. So once again, why are they coming to me? For very low level question. So I'm then, I'm able to develop that, be responsive to that. So Ankerson would say, how and why and when do your people seek coaching and development? And if you know that, it tells you something about them. It also tells you something about how you need to be working with that person and mentoring that person. Question two, everybody lies about this question. Okay, everybody, when asked this question, their first response is, what drives me is getting better. But if you dig into that, a very large majority of us, really what drives us is feeling good. So let's just take a moment on this question. If you want a team that is a high-performing team, if you want a culture of excellence, you have got to get people that are driven to get better. Remember, one of the famous lines out of Jim Collins' work was, good is the enemy of great. This was the big mantra that came out when the book first was published, is, why are companies not great? Because they're good. And good is a good place to be. And that's why there's only 15 companies that were not comfortable with good, they became great. And I'll tell you, when we got this award, I'm just going to go back, we got this award, and I had to fly to Atlanta to get this award, it's an incredibly prestigious award. The team got together and we said, this is the first step towards mediocrity. We actually sat as a team and we said, now that we have gone to Everest, we're going to begin to just plateau. And I said, let's remind ourselves that let this be the switch sort of that takes us to the next level. Because the minute you get that Oscar, the minute you get that thing, you really start to become comfortable with just taking cheap roles and doing Iron Man. You know? So what drives you and what drives your people? And then like I said, ask other people. I think one of the most insightful things is to take someone's daily colleague and say, Mark, tell me, what do you think drives Craig? Is it really getting better, or is it just feeling good and making people around him feel good about the work? And if they say, by the way, I'm driven by getting better, then you ask them for evidence. Tell me a couple times in the last couple weeks where you've been driven to get better. One of the things I'm notorious for doing is after any event, I will send a text to the key players of the event, and I'll say on a scale of 1 to 5. That's all. Actually, I'll just say 1 to 5. And then they'll write back and they'll give me a 4, they'll give me a 5, they'll give me a 3. And then my next question is, why 5? Why did you give it a 5? Or what could we have done to move it to a 5? And then my criticism to me is, Craig, you're always constructively critical as opposed to celebratory, which is a flaw. It is. We'll get to celebration in a minute. So a big question here, Ankerson says the great players didn't care if they won or lost. They wanted their best personal time. I think, once again, using athletics as an example is, many times I know, especially younger kids, the parents want the kids to participate in tournaments so they can go with the trophy, right? And so we're always like, yes, but look at their growth. We had a child recently, the parents looked at their performance on reading, and it was a flat line. They didn't get any better at reading. At the end of the year, their reading had not improved at all. And the parents were coming into the conference going, and the teacher, brilliant teacher, just said, sit, let me show you something. And showed a video of the kid on the playground early in the year. This is a 3 or 4 year old kid. Was hiding behind the bushes at the beginning of the year. They didn't want to talk to anybody, lots of tears, lots of whatever. At the end of the middle of the year, they said how he was going down the slide, helping other people with the slide. And at the end of the year, was the first one to go get the new kid, introduce the new kid to everybody else. And the teacher said, let's talk about real growth. Your kid's 4. What was more important was the sense of belief. So what? Is it feeling good, getting better? Where's the growth? Question next. How much do you care? How much do you want this job and want success? And again, we'll all say, I really, really want it. So you as the leader of the team have to be a bit subversive to get to this. One of the questions I ask in interviews oftentimes, I go to job fairs all over the world. Let me tell you what job fair, some of you might know that. You go to a big hotel in Bangkok, and like 2,000 teachers are looking for jobs in international schools show up. There's 200 schools. We're in a big ballroom. They come and sign up for interviews, and then you go to your hotel room, and then they come for the next 2 days and half-hour interviews, and you do this. What I often do in the first interview, I'll be interviewing you for a high school math position. Then if I really like you, I'll invite you back the next day for a follow-up interview. But in the follow-up interview, I'll just lie. And I'll say, by the way, since you left, we also have a middle school health position open. Would you be more interested in that? And the minute they waver from the position that they're actually applying for is a red flag for me. I want a high school math teacher that only wants high school mathematics. I want to make sure that they care more about that. I often ask them, if you had any choice of a job, and I make up two or three that don't exist, which one would you do? I'm hoping the one you're applying for is the one you really want. The other thing in my business is every year I have teachers that keep applying for a different job. So what do you really want? What they really want is growth on kids. They don't care what the discipline is, but I need to get to that. I don't care if it's math or science or whatever, I really like to watch seventh graders grow. So I realize it's a seventh grade position. It's not about math or English, but you gotta dig into that. Great companies have people working on what they truly care about. And you know this whole thing about put your best people on your best products, not on your problems, is at the key core of this. The last, I mean, if you've got to save the day, send your best person to save the day, but don't leave him. There's a great story of Alok being sent from Mahindra to open up United World College in Pune. So Mahindra was opening up United World College, they had all kinds of regulatory issues, construction issues, whatever. He was working at the time in exports and in dairy for Mahindra. They just picked him up and they said, go take care of this for 1 year. And he's like, ah, school? What am I doing in a school? 25 years later, he's still working in school. And the last question, which I really enjoy, is this is Ankerson's work, not mine. Ankerson would say, the great companies are always asking for, what did you get out of it? And he would say, oftentimes lower performing teams or lower performing individuals will talk a lot about what they liked. And high performing is what they learned. So in other words, you went to a conference, tell me about it. Oh, travel was great, made some really good connections, did this, did that, as opposed to, you know what, I think everything we're doing with regard to X is flawed. You need to go back and take a look at it. So the great teams and the great performers are, when you talk about takeaways from the week, tell me what was the big learning of the week. Tell me what was the big learning of the conference. What was your big learning of that interaction? It's learning, it's not liking. And I'll tell you what, specifically my Indian mid-level employees really struggle with this. They want to tell me everything they like about it. And I got to push harder to say, yeah, I know all that. Yeah, okay, I got to like. What did you learn? And it actually becomes a skill set. I did this recently with a group of football coaches from a company in India called Koo. So we had about 50 coaches, and some of them didn't have very good English. They really struggled with this question. About what did you learn? And it was a professional development week. There was a coach's training week. I said, what did you learn? I really liked that drill we ran. What did you learn about that? And then at the end of the week, Pankaj, their whole mind had been open to start looking for learning as opposed to looking for liking. And it's a mindset, you know, that we really have to dig into. So this is what Ankerson says. Ankerson says the great performers, and he uses athletes, are the ones who are always looking for the opportunity to learn. You go to a football game, you're a professional footballer, how was the game? I love the way the midfielder would drop the ball and rotate to the 60-degree, and the way the goalkeeper would come out. He's learning something, you know? All right, so with that, next quiz, I'm gonna show you a picture. Just raise your hand if you know who this person is. It's not you, Mark. So I was gonna put this picture in, and I googled this person, and a bunch of photographs came up, and in the photographs there was this caricature, and I was like, that actually looks a bit like Mark. So I'm gonna pick this one and use it. So we had a couple of hands go up. Anyone want to blur his name out? Who is this? Okay, that's Malcolm Gladwell. It's a little bit, because this caricature is a bit hard to tell. So we took a look at Medina's work with Brain Rules. We've taken a bit of a look with Jim Collins on Good to Great. We focused on Anderson's The Gold Mine Effect. And if you look at the way he titled it, it's like bringing gold out of a mountain that you don't know gold is in. It's bringing out that best in people. And then you've got Malcolm Gladwell. And I could do a whole weekend just on Gladwell. Right? And I think the two pieces down here, The Tipping Point and Blink. I'm just going to put these out as for your resources. The tipping point is exactly that, is that you get hit and hit and hit and hit and hit something and it doesn't move. And suddenly, someday, you just nudge it and it crushes. So what is that tipping point that moves things from immovable to destroyed. How are we able to do that? What's the tipping point? And oftentimes in that particular work, the tipping point is very people-centric. The tipping point was when that person came on the team. The tipping point is when that leader took over that group of people. It's very people-centric, okay? Number one. The other one is Blink. And Blink is a beautiful, easy read about our first impulse. What's your first reaction to something? And all the research that tells us, especially in your business, the whole marketing and branding and digital design, the first impression is everything. And so the research is telling us, I don't remember exactly the number, but something like 80% of all first impulses are correct, are accurate. And then we actually say, no, I got research, I got talk, we got, you know, I interviewed someone yesterday to lead our student service team. So we have two campuses. We have the elementary kids up to fifth standard on one campus, and 12th standard the IB program on the other one. And we have school psychologists and reading specialists and counselors and, you know, that down here, and we have the same over here. We want someone to lead this team, to sort of really create a student service and support team. So we're interviewing them, and at one point I interrupted, I think, the third candidate, and I said, you know what I really want? I said, I want someone to be just cut through the crap and just get work done. Because these people, and you can, I'm on film, I don't mind, these school psychologists and school counselors and reading specialists really are into process. Their business is process data. There's a kid who on Friday needs an intervention, and I'd like to move on that and get that intervention for that kid. So I said, right now I'm changing, I told the person, I'm changing my rubric, and I'm really looking forward. Tell me about how you work with your gut instinct. How do you move things forward? How do you actually move a process to a product and to an end result? But the book I want to focus on for the purposes of this talk is Outliers. And the basic premise of the book, he calls the book Outliers. The definition of an outlier is a person, place, or an experience that exists outside, far removed from the norm. For instance, my family went on a vacation to the Galapagos Islands. When my kids, my boys were young, we went to the Galapagos Islands. We swam with sharks. We laid on the beach with seals. We watched blue-foot boobies with the huge iguanas. That was an outlier experience. Every vacation for the rest of their lives would be disappointing. Okay? A person. There are those people that are just outliers in certain things. To give you more of a graphic, this is, I want to talk about an outlier. On any given topic, we can create a bell curve. Let's just make sure we all understand a bell curve. A bell curve is, if I chose math right now, and we all took a test in math, one of us would be better than 99% of the rest of us, and one of us, probably me, would be worse than 99% of you two talking, our two mathematicians. But we could bell curve us, all of us. In math, Craig would be standing here, someone else would be standing here, and then we would all go here, and the majority of us would be right here. Everybody understands a bell curve, right? An outlier is this guy over here. So when you look at the bell curve, that is an outlier. So not only the person in this, now maybe someone here is that outlier, but there are these people, and I'm trying to think of the gentleman, the famous Indian mathematician that they just made a movie about. Yes, outlier. Everybody got it now? Outlier. No formal training. Didn't even know how he came up with this stuff. He wrote it, and that's going to be a beautiful movie. I don't think it's come out yet. But it's going to be, you know, it's going to be, once again, really showcasing India and the great, you know, varied culture that we have. That's the outlier. Once again, you hear about Ronaldinho Gaúcho from football, the Messis as young kids. They're just outliers. They're just so far removed from all this. You've got the Mozarts. These are the kids that are way out here. So what Malcolm Gladwell did was he went and studied outliers. And he said, the fall. Okay, so what he did was he studied individuals. What Craig has done is I spent so much time with outliers that I actually think we can translate Malcolm Gladwell's work very loosely to organizations. So I'm going to say that the same things that make for outlier individuals can make for outlier organizations, which once again gets to our ambiance of greatness. And Gladwell says greatness does not rise from nothing. Mozart was not Mozart just because his name was Mozart. Messi did not become Messi just because he was born Messi. And he says, not because of who they are. When he says who, he says all of this stuff that you're born with. By the way, IQ comes from the mother. Alright? As my wife continually tells me with regard to my middle child. You know, he got his IQ from me, I'm like, the other two? But, so you have the who. Gladwell says it is not because of any of this. Gladwell clearly says outliers, and I'm talking about companies now. So in other words, the company is not exceptional because of who they are. It is because of this. It is because, now I'm going to go back to Gladwell, it's about where the child was born. I'm sticking with the individual, just stay with me. I'm going to make the metaphorical jump to organizations. Gladwell says there are individuals that are outliers in their field because of where they were born or where they grow up, of when they were born. This is a great, unbelievable statistic. 99% of all professional hockey players are born in December. True? Absolutely true. 90% of all professional hockey, ice hockey players are born in December. Because in Canada, the competitive leagues, I'm sorry, not December, January. The competitive leagues start January 1, your age. Stay with me. So they're always the oldest kids. So when they start playing when they're 4 years old, they're actually five. Everybody else is actually, like the December births are the worst birth. Because you're actually the youngest kid. And then the best players get picked for the team. They play the most. They go to the next age bracket. They're the best players because they play all the time. And so by the time they go to the professional league, look it up. Outliers. Gladwell will blow your mind with some of this stuff about when you are born. So I will translate when you were born is to when you came into the organization. I worked at one of the most amazing schools 10 years ago that was in its golden age. It was the American School of São Paulo. We had a phenomenal head of school, visionary individual. And that 10 years, people say to this day, those 10 years define international education in South America. We set the bar. We did it. And it's because of when we were there. People who came after us talk about our generation. And I was so envious of everything you guys did when you were there. And the where is Mumbai. Think about this. The teachers that we get to come to Mumbai to work at our school come, most of it, those that don't want to come to India don't come. Those that come, come because we're in India. The where, right now, for your businesses, if this might be the where to be, this might be the when to be. Our greatness will be defined 10 years from now by being in India this year, this generation, with these opportunities. And the other thing is the what and the how, and in the big purple is with whom. With whom did you work? Because that will define your greatness. And we all know that. And the best analogies are sports. You take one player off the team, and I hate to say that, you take one player off the team and the whole culture changes. The whole, everything changes. So, I'm going to show you two tests to see who are outliers in this room, okay? So we're not going to blurt out the answers. I'm going to show you a test. As soon as you get the answer to the test, stand up. And as soon as I have two or three people standing up, I'm going to take the test off the screen. Okay? This is usually when I do this. You've got your North Americans that just kind of like sit in their chair. You've got the Indians putting their books down. They're ready to go. I saw that. You're like, okay, I'm going to win this. I'm a topper. Okay, are you ready? So hold your thing. There are people going to stand up within 2 seconds. There are some of you that will get the answer to this question in 2 seconds. Okay, ready? So I'm going to give you one test. As soon as you're done, just stand up. What's the right answer? Okay. Nobody moved. Let me first tell you why nobody. I'll tell you a few things. I'll do it back again. Right now, there's 4 people in the room that are actually they're remembering all of them and they're ready to go. They know what the answer is. Some of you, because 4 or 5 of you went, you immediately lost the faith to do it. The minute 4 or 5 of you went, it's a graphic thing. Because we had limited ourselves, like, if it's a graphic thing, I'm not a competitor, right? So I'm going to show it to you again. As soon as you get it, stand up. Okay, stop. Stop. You're too slow. So we have these 5 people. They got it. Okay, now stay with me. So remember who these 5 are. Everybody, look at them. See who the 5 are, okay?
How do they got it?
So this is the answer. There are still five people that, even though I gave you the answer, you have not figured it out yet. Your mind, your brain, this is not what your brain does. Your brain may do 99 other things, but this is not how your brain functions. Is there anyone in the room that still doesn't know why? Probably not. It's an easy one. Okay? Ready for the next test? Again, same thing. I'll show it to you for 2 seconds, flash, you gotta get it. But I'm gonna tell you, because it's, I'm gonna tell you, this is what it is. I'm gonna show you a group of things here and a group of things here. You've got to figure out which piece of this group is closest meaning to this group. Got it? As soon as you get it, stand up. Stop. Stop. Were either of you standing on the first one?
Yeah.
Were you?
Yeah.
Okay, you sit down. You're out of that. Okay. Completely different group. A completely different group to the first group. Right? Once again, the first group, you stood up for both because I gave you the questions before I answered you. But she stole the desk. She stole the desk. I saw you climbing in the window. And then a completely different. So what we have, in the simplest of terms, kind of a verbal linguistic strength here. The other one was a structural, systemic, visual learning outliership. Okay? Have a seat. Okay? What's interesting about this one, which is different than the other one, there are people that get the wrong answer and fight for it. Whereas the other one, you can't, actually even the other one, you could probably figure something different. But with this, I have done this before, and I'm about to move on, and so, sir. For me, sir, stairs and elevate is connected, because it's stairs and elevate. Question not clear. So now diving a little bit more into the Gladwell piece, this is what Mark has asked me to hit on. Why do some companies succeed so much further than others? And really, Gladwell bumps this into four buckets. All right? So I'm not taking Gladwell's 250 pages, and I'm just, these are not his buckets, these are my buckets. And I'm telling you that Gladwell is saying the individuals have this, I'm telling you the organizations that have a vision. And I'm not talking about vision stuck on the wall that no one reads. I'm talking about a vision that I can stop your employee in the elevator and say, tell me about the vision of your organization. Where do you see yourselves in 5 years? You should have that, the vision, with the individual outliers. If you ask them, where do you see yourself in 5 years? I see myself as a grandmaster of chess. I will be a grandmaster in 5 years. That's my we have a kid, actually. I'm sorry. It's at a different school. It's a school my son works at. He has a kid in first standard who wants to be a grandmaster in chess. That's his vision. The second one is the kids that were outliers, that grew up to be outliers, they had options. They had a lot of opportunities and a lot of options to pursue their vision. Companies, again, if you only have one or two clients, how great can you be? Options. Thirdly, support. The big bucket is support. No one becomes an outlier on their own. No company is going to be great in a silo. In fact, more today than ever. Alok uses this wonderful analogy with us every time we start talking about doing something at ASP. He goes, boss, we are not in the potato growing business. We are in the potato eating business. We need not grow potatoes to eat, because there's a really good potato growing company across the street. Have them do our potatoes. And that is the support, bringing the potato people to feed us, rather than us doing our own potatoes. It comes about confronting the brutal facts, cutting off what is not core of what we do. So the support of doing that. The other thing about support, at the American School of Bombay several years ago, all of our sports coaches were probably full-time teachers that just happened to be swimmers, or full-time teachers that happened to be badminton players. And so we would never do that in a physics class. We would never hire a swimming coach who knew physics to go teach physics. We would never do that. So we kind of made this vision change up. If we have a child who truly wants to be a great tennis player, he needs access and the support of great coaches. And lastly, there is a great deal of independence in outliers. and I'll talk a bit about this. So these are the four buckets, and I'm gonna, in these buckets, there's like 100 pages of conversation. I'm gonna pick out only, I think, three or four of the specifics. One of the things that Malcolm Gladwell became famous for was this 10,000 hours. This was, you know, if Jim Collins was famous for good to great, or that was his big line that everyone recognizes, the line about Malcolm Gladwell is, all of the outliers had invested 10,000 hours into their craft before their competitors even got around to it. So I'm going to talk a bit about the 10,000 hours. The other one was mentors. Every one of the outliers had very strong mentors, very capable mentors. And these two I want to talk about for a minute. If you want to become a great basketball player and you want to be the outlier in free throw shooting, everybody knows what I'm talking about. Shooting through the free throw. If I say go practice for 10,000 hours, and you practice throwing it like this, or if you practice throwing it like this, you can put as many thousands of hours into it, you're not going to perfect it. And if your mentor says, throw it like that, or throw it like that, then the whole equation of excellence falls apart. The 10,000 hours is about quality instruction. Let me explain to you about how impactful this is. Several years ago at a different school, we did an action research on this. We took a physical education class that was teaching kids how to hop on one leg. All right, that's like four-year-old, you gotta get the motor skills, right? Hop on one leg, hop on the other leg. This is a skill we're trying to teach 3 and 4 year olds how to, you know, motor control. So we wanted to do this, we wanted to put this 10,000 hour to test. What I'm about to tell you will blow your mind almost as much as the January birthdays. We took all the kids in the pretest, all 100 kids in third grade, and we had them do a pretest on hopping. And then we divided the class equally into three different groups of hoppers. Are you with me? Three equal groups of hoppers. We had three PE teachers. All of our PE teachers were more or less the same quality of a teacher. And then they had these 90-minute PE classes, and what they used to do is the kids would hop or do their lesson for 20 minutes, and they'd have a 5 to 7 minute break where they'd go and drink water and do whatever, and then they'd come back and do their lesson, drink water, etc. We asked one class to just stay with that. Do 20 minutes, take a 10 minute break, do 20 minutes, take a 10 minute break, and then the class is over. We asked the other class on the other side, say, don't give any break. Tell Mark, you go take a water break. Or the two of you go take a water break. Then when you're done with your water break, come back and tap two kids on the shoulder, and they'll go take their water break. In other words, the class kept going, but everyone got their break. At the end of this, just because the class got like 12 minutes more instruction times 14 classes, the hopping skills was 25% better in that class because of the 10,000 hours. They just spent more time as a class hopping and with the right instruction. And that is just, if anything, I just said, let's not do math, let's not do reading. Let's do something we can really tangibly see. So the hopping in one class that didn't take the break, but they did offer the break. It wasn't brutal. They got their breaks, but not as a class. It wasn't disruptive. I didn't have to bring it back. I didn't have to get the instructions again. I didn't lose time. And the mentors. I want to just share another very, very sad statistic from American education. Several years ago, an organization took millions of kids from all public schools. And probably the same thing happens in public schools here, where you have no say in who your teacher is in third standard. You know, whatever. You just go from second standard to third standard, and they put you in a class. So what they did is they wanted to see the impact of the highest effective teachers and the impact of the lowest teachers. And these are teachers that have tenure in public schools. You can't fire them. They're totally incompetent, but you can't get rid of them. They're just really bad teachers, and they're going to continue teaching. Everybody with me? So that what the schools had to do behind closed doors with the researchers, they had to bucket their teachers into three categories. Highly effective, effective, and not effective. So there are teachers that are in schools, in American public schools, that their principals are saying they're not effective. I can't do anything about it. They're going to get a class of kids. They're not effective. Then they took all the kids, and they took all the kids at the same percentile. We took a test, and these kids were all at the 50th percentile in that bell curve. So they're at the middle of the curve. And they tracked them for 4 years. Stay with me. So these kids, they were not placed. They automatically kind of went into a non-effective teacher. If the kids stayed with the same caliber of teacher for 3 years, they remained in the study. In other words, they wanted to see the impact after 3 years of having not effective teacher, not effective teacher, not effective teacher, effective, 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 highly effective, highly effective, highly effective. So the million and so kids ended up being like 300,000 by the end. There's one of the 300,000 kids that had the fortune, the good fortune of staying in highly effective teachers three times, or the misfortune of getting put in poor teachers. Then they went into middle school. So they sat third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade. Everybody with me? Million kids study. It ended up being 300,000 kids by the end. 100,000 kids had gone through 3 years of not effective teachers, 3 years of highly effective teachers, and then they all started at the 50th percentile. And in sixth grade, they tested the kids again. And what happens here when you share this with teachers, they actually get pretty emotional. The kids that were at the 50th percentile went into sixth standard, which in the United States we call that middle school. And they had to receive special needs for learning disabled children. In third grade, they were at the 50th percentile. After 3 years, 10,000 hours of crap, 10,000 hours of lousy instruction, they ended up being receiving services for having learning disabilities. And learning disabilities don't happen in fourth grade. The kids who had 3 years of highly effective teachers, 10,000 hours of master instruction, ended up being in what the US calls gifted and talented programs. These two kids in third grade were best friends, same 50th percentile. Their path took them two very different ways. And by the way, the effective teacher, they all ended up being in the 50th percentile. There was no growth. They just maintained. These two things here. So when you take a look at the mentorship, the impact of a teacher, of a coach, of a boss, of a partner, and the relationship with that partner, and then the 10,000 hours of correct instruction, not just time, it's the quality of time, Gladwell would say that's where outliers begin. And the earlier, the better. I'm talking now about your children, but I'm also saying earlier, the better, your employees. The minute you get new people to the team, think about this 10,000 hours. And lastly, and I know I'm running over a little bit, is grit. All of the outliers, whether they're individuals or teams, they just have this, they don't give up. And then there's a line between being gritty and being stupid. Right? And you have the definition of stupid is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. Grittiness is not just that, it's about always being gritty, about finding different ways, but putting your chin into it, your shoulder into it, and getting the work done. And lastly, all of the great outliers were coming out of organizations that had traditions. There was a tradition. And I think even young companies, like a Magenta that's 5 years old, needs to start building that culture of traditions. And one of these traditions is celebrating success. Gladwell tells you about the outliers who celebrate success, celebrate real success. When you start celebrating mediocrity, you have just informed your community that we're going to really celebrate okay. And so you'll see some companies that actually void, like they will forego the event that year. You know what? No one hit it. No one hit it this year. Or so the tradition of celebration was a really high one in Gladwell's thing, is that these are athletes or these are musicians that were celebrated for their real success, as opposed to acknowledged with the gold star for participation. So again, in your organizations, I think that would be an interesting thing to take a look at. So Medina, open up the brain, we get into the good to great. What are those six things? And really the people, the purpose, the values. But then we take a look at Ankerson's four questions. We end with Gladwell. Kind of did that. Sorry, took a look at grit. And the last thing that I want to talk about is Daniel Pink's book, Drive. Again, this is something that has changed the way the American School of Bombay even thinks about things. Daniel Pink, again, if you're following him on Twitter, you should be following Gladwell on Twitter, you should be following Daniel Pink on Twitter, you should be following, you know, Medina on Twitter. Daniel Pink's book, Drive, is the surprising truth about what motivates people. And highly performing companies, great companies that have clear purpose, they're hiring the right people, and they have the values of a culture of excellence, this is his formula. His formula is, he's interviewed everybody, and we know it's not money, and we know it's not geography, and we know it's not all that. The thing that motivates people are these three things. The autonomy to get the job done. Even though we all agree what the job is, give me the autonomy to do it my way. Be my mentor, be my coach, hold me accountable, but I need some autonomy. I remember 20 years ago in the United States, in the state, like I think it was the state of New York, they gave every kindergarten teacher a minute by minute lesson plan of what they had to do. And a big exodus of master teachers left. They basically said at 9 o'clock you'll take attendance, at 9:01 you'll read, at 9:02 you'll send them to the toilet, at 9:04 you'll do this, no autonomy. I didn't get into the education business for this piece of paper. Purpose, I think, you know, especially the Indian millennials, as Mark mentioned, all of a sudden the Indian millennials are very interested in the purpose of. The number one, you all know this, the number one reason people leave their company is because their understanding of the expectations and their supervisors' understanding of expectations were not the same. It's like, I thought that's what you want me to put my time into. Actually, no, that's not a high priority for me. One of the things I really enjoyed from my leadership team asking me, say, Craig, of these four things, I'm going to put my money, how much rupees on each of this, what are you thinking? So I'm aligned with that. Yeah, I think we're aligned. Put 50 rupees on that one. That's the big payoff. And lastly, great performers want to be great. They want to be masters of their domain. And the only way you become a master is by putting in the time. And putting the time on two or three things. And if you have a team where you have people running all over the place, a good example, I'll use it just because Rachel and Jody are here. In our advancement office, for the last couple of years, we had this thing about our alumni. You know, we need to get we're a 35-year-old school, our alumni are now 35. We need to start, you know, bringing the village in. You know, they're all over the world. And we began to realize, you know, is that really where we want to put our money on, the alumni, rather than the current parents, the current students, the current market, the current everything else? And really, it was an epiphany one day. We just said, you know what? Cut. Let's not focus on alumni right now. We'll get back to that next year. Okay. So it's about the purpose, the mastery, and the autonomy. So, pulling all this together, you got Angerson plus Pink plus Gap Bagwell plus Craig. This is what I did this morning. After putting all this together, I said, this has got to make some sense. So, how much do you care? These are the questions Angerson gives us. How much do you really care about the job? He's saying, cultures of greatness are, if you can get to this, how much do you care? Why and where and how are you getting coached and how are you being developed? Do you do things to feel good or do you do things to get better? And lastly, how did you learn? The developing piece. So if that's Angerson, then this is Pink. Pink says purpose plus autonomy plus mastery is equal to drive. And a driven organization and a driven employee will be better if they're doing the 10,000 hours in the right way than the rest. And then Gladwell's was individual outliers or organizations that are outliers have a vision, they've been given the independence, they have options, and support. So I put all this out this morning on the table and I said, how do all these come together? Well, we've got what did you learn? Purpose. So we got those two agreeing on it. We have vision, which is a purpose. So those two are agreeing on it. Wow. Why coaching and development? Purpose. So again, we have these two thinkers and these two researchers completely aligned. How much do you care? I would say is an autonomy thing. That how much do you care? How about the independence is a pure synonym for autonomy. Options, I have choices, I have autonomy. Support leads to mastery. How can I master the violin if I'm not with a master violin teacher? What, is it feeling good or is it getting better? If you're wanting to be getting better, you're gonna lead to mastery. The coaching and development leads to mastery. So as I look at all this chaos of what we just talked about for the last hour, I realize this, creates an ambiance of greatness. And with that, I am open to a conversation.
Thank you. I just want to, just quickly, that was very important and completely blown away. I have a question.
Yep.
I'm just going to start taking lots of notes. I just wanted to reflect back on the purpose you were talking about, and you know, how do you at the American School articulate your purpose as your school, and as a principal, you know, your principles, which you know, sort of like that, through your students, through your teachers, through you know, your wider stakeholder group. You know, and then you have other institutions that your students are passing on to. How do you pass that on?
So let me tell you how, not only the American School of Bombay, but I think most high-functioning schools probably approach purpose the same way. So I'm going to share what sort of we do, and it probably would so in education, we have something which is called the profile of a graduate. Okay, so you would have like a profile of a customer, or you would have the profile of an unsatisfied customer. You would have the profile of an unsatisfied graduate. Graduate meaning they've gone through our school. We would consider profile of a graduate someone who's been in our school for more than 3 years. The average tenure of our transient population, we have a transient population, it's about half our kids that are here for 3 to 5 years, and then we have the Indian nationals that are here as long as they're in India, of their lives. So we have this duality there. And so we would say, what is the profile of a graduate? And then as a community, we come together every 5 years, and we say, what are our values? What are our skills that we want them to have? What are the dispositions that we want them to have? And we actually build all of this. So we have a profile of a graduate. And then that becomes sort of the guide. This is what we want our product to be. And over the course of time, the purpose of the American School is as follows. The American School wants to inspire all of its children. So we could have said, teach all our children, make our children happy. We chose the verb to inspire. So to inspire all of our children, but to inspire them to what? We want to inspire them to continuous inquiry. We could have said inspire them to excellence, inspire them to competitiveness, inspire them to lifelong learning, which was a phrase. So at the American School of Bombay, purpose, we have all come together and we've said, we want to inspire all of our children to continuous inquiry. And then we've said, as a purpose, is asking questions the end game? No. So what do we have to do? And empower them with skills. So our purpose continues, inspiring to continuous inquiry, empowering them with the skills. They need to know how to do calculus. To answer their questions, they have to know how to write well. They have to know how to perform on stage. They have to know skills. So the skills, and then we went into dispositions. The skills necessary, and then we said, of all the dispositions, and I'll tell you, when you as a company say, what are the dispositions we want our clients to identify with us, all those adjectives and those hyphenated adjectives and those non-adjectives that you collected, you could go on and on and on. The American School of Bombay really became disciplined, and we said, courage, integrity, and optimism. We feel in the world today, we want our children to be questioning, skills to answer questions, but the dispositions to have courage, integrity, and optimism. For what? To pursue their dreams. So then the next piece of our purpose is to pursue their dreams, and then we put a period there and we said, still didn't feel complete. And by the way, you can put beautiful language in. We really, as a school especially, you kind of have to walk when you talk. And then we put a comma instead and we said, and enhance the lives of others. Because in today's world, with children with courage, optimism, and integrity, if they're not enhancing the world in which they live, I think we've been given a gift by being in Mumbai, because it's so easy for us to fill that part of our purpose, because there's so much need and so much that we can learn from Mumbai. So the purpose of the American School of Bombay was created by a very simple exercise every 5 years by our community coming together, shareholders coming together, saying, what are the skills of the graduate, which is the product? What are the dispositions? If we did this, what would education look like? So that's all we're going to do. It becomes easy for us to figure out what's relevant education. You asked me my adjective. I said relevance. At the American School of Bombay, we're very rigorous about relevance. Are we teaching our kids, or are we developing our kids for yesterday, or today, or tomorrow? And we like to think that we're developing them for today and tomorrow. And that really forces a lot of things to be cut. That's not relevant anymore. Forget it. Right now. Penmanship. Big debate. Penmanship. Because you all know that within 5 years, no one will be writing anything. Fight it all you want. I'm a writer, I'm a published writer, I keep a journal every night, I have a beautiful ink pen, Parker pen, I will always have it. But this fourth grader, when he graduates from high school, he will probably never. Typing is almost gone. My youngest son is dyslexic, severely dyslexic and dysgraphic, meaning can't basically read and write, and outlier from a comprehension perspective. He has software, all his emails that he sends to people are perfect, because he has a software called DragonSpeak, and it's hooked up to his computer, and he just speaks to his computer and types it. and he has a natural cadence. So when he says, how are you? It puts the question mark. Because he's trained the computer, artificial intelligence, to respond to it. So everyone thinks that Spencer can really read and write because his emails are beautiful, but he just speaks into them. He's very well spoken. So once again, I think relevance, so all that is towards the profile. So I think to answer your question, about purpose is bringing the stakeholders together, identifying the services, the dispositions, etc., and then putting it all together to most, I would say most ASB teachers and kids, you just ask them what's the purpose of the school, and they'll tell you. Inquiry, inspiration, courage, optimism, dreaming, and enhancing lives of others.
And I think your point of relevance, because you do have your stakeholder group is continually changing. I mean, if it's 30% every year, then in 3 years, it's 100%.
But also,
but
the 50% of the Indian nationals, you know, they stay forever.
Yeah.
But there's this other 50 that's churning. But the other thing which is interesting is we went from zero Japanese to 75 Japanese?
Lots.
To lots of Japanese within like 3 years. Like in the past 3 years, because there was a Japanese school, there is a Japanese school here, right? So within 3 years, we went from having no Japanese to our school to some big chunk. We went from having very few Koreans to a big chunk of Koreans, so that changes everything. You know, you've got to get that voice in there, right? Right now, American School of Bombay, when we're having big meetings, big meaning hundreds of people, we have simultaneous translation for our Japanese and our Koreans because they are a very important and engaged communities as a, you thinking of your stakeholders. And if they're not with us for the purpose, you know, there's a good friend of mine, great friend of mine, I never want to work for him. He runs a British school, not in India. And I've been to one of his orientations with new parents before. And this is what he says. I love him to death. In his very strong Cockney accent, he'll say, welcome, I won't try and do that. And he'll say, welcome to the British School of Jakarta. We are so thrilled to have you here. Don't try and change us. Welcome to the British School. This is the way we've done it. This is the way we will continue to do it. Do not try to change us. And that is their purpose. They know exactly what they are, and they are not compromising on that, and they have a constituency, and they have a client that wants that and gets that. People often ask me, what's the best school in Mumbai? And I say, depends, what are you looking for? Are you looking for mango? Are you looking for banana? When I want a banana, and you give me, you know, pineapple, I'm not enjoying it. I wanted a banana. And I think in the city, by the way, there are 49 schools in Mumbai that have the word international in their name. 6 years ago when I got here, it was like 11 or 17. There's an organization called the Heads of School, International Schools in Mumbai. It used to be, it would all be my living room. And now there's like 49 of us. And we've not even got together anymore. Because we're so, we don't even have a common conversation. We're so different.
I just wanted to address another important aspect of this question about how you reinforce the mission and vision. And just to share that it's such an ongoing process. And there are many times where our team or different groups of team members, they kind of go astray because we get distracted by something. And it's that widely known mission and vision that inevitably like puts us on track. It's like it's kind of like always a beacon out there. So someone will say, wait a minute, this is really
mission driven.
Is that really serving our mission or what we're about? Someone will say it and we'll think about it. We're like, oh gosh. Really got off track here.
You know, another thing, just for those of you that are leading teams, we have board meetings every quarter, and so we have the nameplates. So you're the audience, the board will be sitting up here, and the board will say, you know, Mr. Johnson. So you all can know that I'm the board member whose name is Mr. Johnson. On the back side of the mission statement facing Mr. Johnson is the mission and purpose of the school, which we put there, and I remind all board members, as we're having a conversation about the strategic thinking of the school, remember, this is the mission of the school. Which is kind of other questions, please.
Thank you very much, by the way. One thing I want to say is thank you so much for qualifying inspiration. So many people just say we want to inspire, and I'm like, what?
What does that mean?
You make a cup of tea, or you know what?
Yeah. Before you ask your question, can I make sure we all get that? One of the things I'm often asked to do as a consultant when I go into a company is to take away, or not take away, these very loaded words and phrases and deconstruct them down into a workable definition for that team. And I'll tell you what, I love that work because we're all coming in with what inspiration means from a different place, but if we're going to work as a team, we need to know what that is. I would highly recommend you as a team saying, saying, we talk about this language, let's make sure we understand what we mean by that. And one more thing we say about that, I did a similar activity for Teach for India, and we're going through a process of revalidating their core values. And I think they had like 9 core values, and we were in this huge gymnasium, and we had all the core values up, and we had like 100 people that had little stickies. So they had 3 stickies that they had to go and put on the 3 core values that they felt were most important. So they did all of this. So 100 people had 3 stickies. So there's 300 stickies that could be applied to 8 core values. At the end of the day, 2 of the core values had not even 1 sticky. I've never worked in an organization that at that moment said, we need to reevaluate. Boom. 8 core values, meaning all equal, all of a sudden 2 didn't get a single vote. It's not that they weren't important. It's that no one thought they were the top 3. Brilliant insight. So this inspiration again, what does it mean? Yes, Lucy.
You work in a very diverse environment with the whole nature of the school. You must mean a lot of different sort of cultures and approaches and mindsets coming together. And I was wondering what you do, and you must be doing it on a day-to-day basis, to successfully meld that sort of diversification. So, you know, if I can characterize it very broadly, sort of the extrovert West versus the innate conservatism, if you like, of Indian society.
You know, it's very interesting. When I was in Brazil, you know, you've got the Brazilian Latino culture that has got its culture, and then you have the very Western. We had a large Mormon population from Utah that had come, you know, from missions down to the school. And then we had large Japanese, I don't know if you know this, but there are more Japanese in the city of São Paulo than there are in any city in the world outside Tokyo. So in other words, there's no Japanese city outside of Tokyo that has more Japanese than in São Paulo. Just
like,
a few things.
Like the Greeks in
Melbourne. Like the Greeks in Melbourne. So oftentimes there, when we would have these moments of tension, we would sit down and say, let us remember that we are the American school of São Paulo. In other words, we're the American school of São Paulo. And I think that we do a lot of new parent orientation. I mean, we really spend a lot of time with our new parents, culturizing them to what is our culture as a school? What is acceptable for us? For instance, yesterday, last week, we had a parent, a middle school child, call a German, an Indian boy called a German kid, you're a Nazi. I'm going to start calling you Hitler. And I don't know if you know this, but last week was Holocaust Day, Holocaust Remembrance Day. So maybe that's why it started, and then on the bus home, this happened. So as we began to have a conversation about this, the Indian parent said, he just meant, like, you're stupid. And, you know, if you had said you're stupid, we would have dealt with that, but it wouldn't have been elevated to like a racial, ethnic, kind of slur, hate crime kind of thing. The kid really didn't mean you're a Nazi Hitler. They had just come out of a class of Holocaust remembrance. He's a German kid. I'm an Indian kid. And this beautiful moment arose where the Indian parent suddenly stepped back and realized, yeah, wow, I'm at ASB. I'm at the American School of Bombay with this culture. And to just call somebody a Nazi, where 15% of our population is German, and this is Holocaust week, everybody's on chains, was a very powerful moment. So lots of new parent orientation, lots of case studies with the new parents. Let's say if this were to happen, how would we respond? And then once again, simultaneous translation. We do English class for all of our non-English speaking parents. So when we were going to be doing parent conferences, before parent conferences, the Korean parents would come in and go through in Korean and in very slow English, how do you engage with a parent conference at the American School of Bombay? What's the parent, role of a parent, role of us? So once again, to your space, I would once again say, our typical client is this. But we have these satellites of other clients. How are we gonna get those clients to understand the culture? And how are we gonna adapt to them? Right now, Lucy, we've done something that no other school in the world has done, is we have worked with British schools in the UK, schools in Canada, schools in Korea, public schools in Korea and Botswana, whatever. And we're actually starting to build a document that shows the Korean parents, when you come here, this is what they'll be doing in third standard in Korea. this is what we're doing in third standard here. By the time you go back in fifth standard there, these different standards would not be met. So we have Korean school on a Saturday morning where that is going to be met. So once again, it's sort of like capturing what is needed, what we can, what we cannot do. And really, you all know this because this is your business. Communicate, communicate, and communicate. Question?
I want to talk about three key things that you said, which is being impressed to stay relevant. You keep asking these stupid questions, and that sometimes of course rejecting nostalgia, give away some of your most important beliefs or institutions. Now, if you happen to be an organization that's transforming, and fortunately, unfortunately, transforming at a time when the markets are transforming, the entire economy is transforming, so there's just too much disruption. And then this process happens once, and it quickly happens again. How do you make sure that the teams that are working on these systems that are set up and then dismantled, and then set up and then dismantled, they understand that you're still applying the filter of the mission, even if you know what the quality you are? How do you make sure it's apparent to them? They don't then, even if they're not core, begin to have conversations outside that take away from the strength and the focus of the core team?
Let me answer that in 4 points. First of all, just to correct you, you said when you find these things that are really, really important that you won't do anymore. No, I would. I think the point is they're no longer important. I think things that were once important. So I just want to clarify that. So I would say 4 things. I did say that every 5 years we go through this process. Every 5 years we go through a process of looking at our core values. But the whole idea of strategic planning, honestly, lasting more than a year is so obsolete, especially in most of your markets, right? We used to, 15 years ago, we'd have these 3 to 5 year strategic plans where we would plan what we were going to do 5 years from now. It's inconceivable. I don't even know what's going to happen. The amount of change in the education landscape right now with regard to online learning and MOOCs and, you know, transdisciplinary, it's just crazy. I cannot even imagine what schools are going to look like in 5 years. So number one is I would not set any target beyond what you and your industry feel is a good enough time that you're not going to become irrelevant. So that in one industry, maybe 6 months where you all come back together and re-evaluate the end result that you're working on, or is in your industry is a year a good time? We feel right now in schools, 2 to 3 years, we can kind of set strategic things there. The second thing I would say is we have all of our strategic work done. I can't even think of the name of the software. It's done on a software where everybody on the team has access to it. The board does, the leadership team does, whatever, and we can actually see when things are complete. And we're constantly asking ourselves, is this where we want to be investing our time? Always coming together, whether it's online, face-to-face, to just constantly take a look at that. I think that the only way you ensure that you are working on relevant things is to ask yourself if you're working on relevant things. I'm going to share a quote by a brilliant child psychologist. Again, if you have any boys, if you have sons, this is the guy. His name is Dr. Michael Thompson, and he only writes books, and he is a child psychologist only for young boys. So I have 3 of them, so I'm a big Michael Thompson fan. And he was presenting to our school one time, and someone asked him, he was talking about a moral school, M-O-R-A-L, a moral school. And someone asked him, Dr. Thompson, if you were just to give us one line about how you'd identify a moral school, what would that be? And without hesitation, Dr. Thompson said, a moral school is a school that is constantly asking itself what it is to be a moral school. So I think my answer to you is, and at the American School of Bombay, I would say a relevant organization is an organization that is constantly asking itself, honestly, brutally honestly, are we relevant? And I think right now, I'm not meaning to use Tata again, but that example I watched on TV last night, Tata is looking at some of its oldest sort of departments and saying, you know what? Somebody else does potatoes better than us. Kind of let it go. A couple more questions? I don't know.
The builders did that exercise about 20 years ago.
Same thing, where are we going to cut?
And they cut off all the non-core businesses and consolidated on their core. And they are probably 25 times ahead of the process.
It's hard. Especially a family business like that. My grandfather started that.
3 generations. 3rd generation comes into power because his father just passed away. Yeah. And it was untimely for him to come. And the first thing he did was decide everything.
Wow.
I
just had a thought on based on planning for more than, you know, for more than 2 years. What we can learn is have a 3 or 5 year plan and do, though we know it is not relevant. And just look every quarter when you make a change, how you are changing it over the quarter. So you get a good idea of where you are moving in terms of the depth of where you should be going. So don't throw away long-term plans, but you must know that it is irrelevant except the dynamic part of the
space. Actually, and a little bit more on Pankaj's point here, Jody's husband, Sean Solak, he's the CEO of Lighthouse, private equity firm, and is a board member and a parent at the school. He was on the board for a while when we were developing the strategic plan, and it was very interesting. He created a strategy that to this day we use. So, like, as Pankaj said, let's say we have four strategic end results. One is, let's just say, capturing more clients. One is like infiltrating the Gujarati marketplace. The other one is taking a look at new engineering and automotive, whatever that might be. Take a look at that. Sean said, and then put one which he called the aha strand. The aha strand. And the aha strand, what Sean meant was, if you focus only on these three things, you're actually ignoring the market space. You're not paying attention to what popped up that didn't exist, or an opportunity that didn't exist when you built the plan. So what happens if you are, and like Alok is my aha guy, his job in the strand is to keep his eyes open for any opportunity that could actually become more important than Gujarat. So while he's looking at the aha thing, I'm focusing as a CEO of the company moving in this direction. All of a sudden he comes in and goes, you know what? Forget Gujarat, man. Goa. So then we look at Gujarat, we look at Goa, and we just cut Gujarat and go to Goa. But if we weren't looking at aha, we're going to focus on Gujarat, and 5 years later we're going to have missed Goa. So I think what Pankaj is saying is always coming back, keeping that up there, but always having one person or one team out there, which is an R&D, an American School of Marketing, R&D team out there looking. We were looking actually exactly this. We were looking at opening up a branch school in Gujarat. I don't have the data to say this, but I think Gujaratis have more percentage of children in boarding schools than probably any other state. You go to Panchgani, the Marwaris. Okay. You go up to Panchgani, Mahabaleshwar, District Satara, that area where all those boarding schools, Pune, United World College, you know, Hill Springs and all that, full of Marwaris, Gujaratis, etc. And we were thinking, as a school, of opening up a branch in Gujarat. So they wouldn't have to, because we don't have boarding, we talk about having a boarding. We have so many kids who want to come to the school who don't live here. If we did have a boarding, we could fill it. Suddenly, I didn't know there was like a royal family of Goa. I guess there's a royal family of Goa. I didn't know that. You probably know that. The royal family called the school and said, we will give you the land. We'll give you everything. Put a satellite school in Goa. So really, this Gujarat Goa thing happened in real time for the American School of Bombay. And then we started thinking, wow, Gujarat, we get the Marwaris, we get the Gujaratis, we get whatever. Goa is the expats. The reason they wanted that is because a lot of the expats that come to Goa, they come for 6 months and they leave because they don't have schools for their 7-year-old or 8-year-old that are good schools. But if there was a good school that could meet the needs of the expats, they feel they would have a stronger, not just a, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, it would actually be families that would come and stay. So we have these two things now, we have to make a decision. Like, where do we put our time? Do we give this idea to one of our families to go run with? Or does the American school do that? Etc. The aha. So the aha spend, the Pankaj was talking about.
So what is more relevant in that?
That's right. I think if we were to do it, it would be gone. If you really take a look at which of these two populations is more relevant to our core right now, it would be the expatriates. Because the Gujaratis can find good Gujarati schools. The expats really struggle with finding a school in India that meets their needs. So that's what we know.
I hate learning and talent from a large conglomerate, and I'd really like the point to make on, did I like that or did I learn that? And I think that is like the malaise. I just want to know, while it's far more easier to enforce that in a school environment, do you have ideas for how you can actually take that form in a corporate environment?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that I think a lot of great companies do is you push your people to teach your people. I think this is what I would say. Is that oftentimes a lot of your professional development, a lot of your growth opportunities is run by the leadership team. And I would push on that and I would say, you know what, everyone should have their workshop once a quarter, once a semester, where they have to work with their boss, the talent person, and come up with something that's relevant for growth, do the research, and then come in. Because if you're forcing people to teach, then they have to learn. And by the way, we all know the best way to learn something is to teach it. So I think that the way of holding them accountable for the teaching is making them teach. That's what I'm
doing. I just want to give an example. In TCS, everybody has to have 15% of his time devoted to taking classes. Mm-hmm. and another 15% actually attended. I think there's a, it's a little different, 15, 10, depending on the state, but it is compulsive, so no performance appraisal happens in that in our class.
And so the next step of that is, if you have 15% of your time taking classes, then you would save 5% of your time teaching the classes. Well, we send people out all over the world, and they come back from conferences, and then their direct supervisors are kind of responsible to say, now share with the rest of us, what did you learn? Don't share with them. You can share what you like when we're having a drink together in the evening, but right now I want to know, what did you learn? Couple, do we have time for a couple more questions?
Sure.
Yes, Father.
Question this
time. Next time, Father, you must sit front row. When you're presenting, I'm coming.
Question is, for an outlier, and I'm talking about the individual, how much is how much does it, do you have to have it intrinsically vis-a-vis acquired?
When you say intrinsic, are you talking about born with or found from within? Like
Found from.
Oh, I would say incredible amount. I don't think that research would suggest that 100% of all outliers are deeply intrinsically motivated. However, a lot of the research in education would also suggest that intrinsic motivation, the skills to turn on yourself, are often taught by very effective mentors. We have, like for instance, I have a child, a boy in Brazil who now is playing professional football in Switzerland. When I met him when he was about 9 years old, and now he's probably 25 or 30, he really was a very shy kid. And when it comes to penalty kicks, like taking a penalty kick by yourself, penalty kicks are very difficult to take, but they're actually very easy. No one should ever miss a penalty kick. You shouldn't ever miss a penalty kick. And yet, Baggio and Maradona, they all miss penalty kicks. This kid right now is the designated penalty kicker for his professional team in Switzerland, because he became an outlier in penalty kicks because of our ability to create a skill set where he doesn't see anything, he doesn't feel anything. The goalkeeper is simply a cone, and all he has to do is put the ball between the cone and the post. And he has disciplined himself to where he shuts everything out, because he was so shy, he would stammer, he couldn't get on stage. And we spent years working with him of just shutting on everything, focusing on the task. And so I think, once again, he's deeply intrinsically motivated to do this, but he needed the skill sets that we as teachers and mentors are able to do. Yeah. Oh, yes, sir. Then the middle one did in between. So one would send two, great, thank you, I forgot to mention that. So the three hopping groups, one would break the whole class down and send them on break. One would only let two go at a time. The other one would send like six at a time. So they're trying to be as least disruptive as possible to most disruptive, and then see the impact on learning. The other thing, which your brain rule says this, your generation, your generation say you can multitask, right? So you're on the computer, but you've got something, a podcast going on. Like when I'm on the computer, I'll listen to music, but I refuse to listen to music with lyrics I can understand. Like I'll listen to Italian, or I'll listen to something else like that, or just, but if I listen to English lyrics, I can, actually your brain is distracted. Brain rules will tell you that multitasking is a complete false myth. It doesn't exist. You cannot multitask. What you can do is do many things at different second intervals. So for six fractions of a second, you're typing. Six fractions of a second, you're listening to your music. Six fractions of a second, you're watching the driver, you know, while you're in the car. But you're actually not multitasking, driving, listening to music, and typing. So you're actually doing one third of the work. That's a fact. Yeah, it's a fact. Dad, I can multitask. Actually, you cannot. If you could, you'd be an alien. But as a human being, you cannot. The research tells us you cannot. Now, you might want to spend three times as long to get your homework done because you're watching TV and you're doing whatever, which is great, knock yourself out. But no, if you were to focus and just do one task, you would do it better and you'd do it faster. Good luck telling the millennials that.
I think some of the women in the room might disagree.
You can't actually disagree. Okay.
Women are great multitaskers.
No, that's true. Women actually, the brain says the distance between them flipping is actually shorter than
males, we are actually worse at doing more at the same time, but not multitasking at the same time.
I'll give you that one. So I just wanted to say thank you. I promise I will be talking for much less than 10 minutes to keep you all engaged. Fantastic to be. I've learned so much. About people and purpose and values and all of that leading to this culture of excellence. You know, we've actually defined it here, and I hope that everyone will be able to use that. You know, you've got this definition of greatness. You know, let's all move from being just a good company or a good manager or a good, you know, team player to being a great one. You know, we see how here it's actually possible and it's tangible and, you know, you can really do it. I think also we can start by being nostalgic and being much more courageous. And, you know, we can all be sort of guilty of saying, oh, well, it's always been like that, you know, but we can change, step changes, bit by bit, you know, and being bold and courageous. And, you know, and let's get on that bus and define your hedgehog. I want to see a little email from you all. I think that, you know, I've learned a lot. And, you know, we use this word learning, and I think it's actually been brought into a reality, you know, that what is a learning. And, you know, I have to say, I did like the talk, and I have learned. So let's not be good, let's be great. So I just have a little thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Magenta, you guys
thank
are
you.
Great partners. It's our pleasure to be here. And good luck with the thinking fresh as it continues.
One more.
And this is for you alone. For my aha officer.
It's actually, we just found it was a very special friend's birthday today, Kamlesh.
Oh,
happy birthday.
All the way from China. You deserve it.
I feel honoured.
Thank you.
So everyone feel free to hang around for a bit and have a coffee and do a bit of networking. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank
you. Oh, sorry, one thing I forgot to say before everyone rushes up. On the back of your ID card is a QR code. Go into that and give us some feedback. That would be great. So we're using technology to get fresh thinking. There's another new thing. Thank you very much. That's fine. Yeah. So
it's
Thank you.